gentlemen, now we are here again. It's so good to have you here. A warm welcome to Amsterdam.
Also from my side, a big welcome, and it's great to see all of you.
For those who are attending the WinCCOA User Days for the very first time, let me introduce us here on stage. My name is Martina Hubert. I'm the head of marketing, and my partner on stage is...
Dan Stauffer. I'm the head of sales and marketing for WinCC Open Architecture.
So let us have a look who has come from the various continents to here. As we have guests from all continents, may I first of all ask all the Americans to stand up shortly.
Morning sport, all the Americans, please.
Let us have a glance to those who have crossed the ocean to come here. Americans,
so these
let
are
us see who you are.
So they have traveled more than 7,000 kilometers to join us here. That's really great. But what about our guests from Asia and Middle East? Where are all the Koreans, the Indians, the guys from Hong Kong, Lebanon, United Arab Emirates, Egypt, and Pakistan? Please stand up. We want to see you as well. Wow. Wow, so many. Thank you. Good to have you here.
We have also, or we expect also one guy from South Africa. He traveled more than 9,000 kilometers to come here. But one guy had definitely the longest journey. Please welcome our guest from Australia, Trevor, who had traveled more than 16,000 kilometers.
Trevor, where are you? Wow.
But of course, we are a lot of Europeans here as well. We didn't travel that long, but look how many they are. Europeans, please stand up.
Well, that's obviously the majority. So
yeah, for sure.
I have to work on the other regions.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. But before we rush into the program, let me say a big thank you to our colleagues from the Netherlands. They were so amazingly helpful in organizing this event. And by the way, they found this extraordinary location here. Tell me your opinion. How do you like it here?
Okay, those who have already been here know that it's a tradition actually to start with our WinCCOA keynotes in the morning. But this is only one aspect of this year's User Days. Martina, what else have we prepared this year for our partners and customers?
Yeah, after the keynotes in the morning, we have five different presentations from our WinCCOA partners prepared for you. We selected them, and they will show you their solutions with WinCCOA.
Well, and these presentations may hopefully raise a lot of questions and feedback from all of you. So this is the reason why we have a Q&A session at the end of the day. However, I know that sometimes a question might pop into your mind during a presentation, but I think it might not be nice just to interrupt the presenter. So for this one, we have introduced the so-called question-answer tool. Right, Martina?
Yes, that's right. You can find this question-answer tool in our mobile event service. Don't hesitate to try it during this day. You can see all the event details at a glance. You can contact other participants and can ask questions. If you haven't discovered it yet, please try it during the day. Then collect all your questions, and we'll answer them all together at the end of this day at the question and answer session. If you need help, please feel free to approach one of us, and we will be happy to assist you.
And what about breaks? What besides the networking do we have prepared during the breaks for our partners and customers?
We prepared a partner mini fair. Maybe some of you already have been there. It's in the foyer of the Koppelkirk. And our partners, Gasuni, Siemens, Mobility, and Larsen & Toubro present their solutions with WinCCOA. And they are looking forward to see you there. We have also prepared one solution, Industry 4.0 solution with WinCCOA, which we developed in cooperation with Fraunhofer.
All right. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's plunge into the first morning keynote. I would like to welcome our local host. He is the head of division factory automation here in the Netherlands. He and his team do a lot, actually, also to drive forward the WinCCOA business in the Netherlands. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome with me Mr. Freek Marx.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the cities, to the center of the world. I had to say, I was asked by the mayor of Amsterdam to call it like that. But he knows that I'm from Rotterdam. And there's always a little bit difficulties between Rotterdam and Amsterdam, like the coming weekend, whereas Ajax will play, and also Feyenoord as the local football clubs. And it will be the last game of the year, and it will be decisive who will be the champion. But anyway, welcome to the center of the world. And you saw the plate, I think, and I said to Soko Simic, my colleague, I said, we're actually in the center of the world. We know a lot of nationalities here in Netherlands, in Amsterdam specifically. Over 60 are around normally. So we are, with half of the nationalities we are used to, sitting in this room. And I think we should be proud of that. Before I start, you might have expected maybe the CEO from Siemens Netherlands, Mr. Van der Touw, but Mr. Van der Touw had some private issues at the last moment he could not join. So he gives his best regards to you. This is something you might know. I have to be honest, the reaction in the Netherlands to this movie was astonishing. Many people laughed about it, and many people were also a little bit critical to that. It was, of course, related for those who did not see the movie. Did everybody see the movie? Okay. I could have expected, but it was, of course, after the inauguration of Donald Trump becoming the president of the US, and the question from the Netherlands to become number second. And then the first thing we said, we are always coming in number second, but to be behind the US is not so bad, actually. If you look at the Netherlands, and I took some pictures from this movie, I didn't want to show the movie because I think everybody saw it, but the Netherlands is a kingdom, meaning that we have a king and also a prime minister, and actually the prime minister tells everybody what to do and where to go forward to, and the king advises him. It's a little bit different than how it was ago, about 5 centuries ago, because then, of course, the king told the people what to do. It changed a little bit. If you look at the weather in Netherlands, then I would describe it like this: wind and a lot of water, both in the sea, but also from the air. Luckily, we have a nice day today. We have sun, so I'm very happy with that, because it was a pretty long walk from the parking garage to here, and I did not want to be completely soaking and tell you that it was raining outside. So happily, luckily, it was very good weather. But this also means that, let's say, this water took us in the last centuries to become a business model. If you look at the right side, something which I took from Rotterdam, because we are very proud in Rotterdam, of course, on our harbor, which is the number 4 global, number 2 in Europe. And it depends a little bit, but now it's maybe number 1 again, but at least there is a lot of stuff going on there. We have a lot of bridges where our colleagues from mobility will come back to also in the next day. And we have a lot of tunnels also. And also on the left upper side, you will see where we protect ourselves from the sea, because we are beneath the sea level. We call it New Amsterdam's Pijl, which means actually that this is a zero line, and there are parts of the country that are meters below this zero line. So we need a lot of dikes and a lot of protection against the water. Because we had this flood back in the 50s where a lot of people died, and this is what we do not want anymore. This is also the reason why the Netherlands is being asked, for instance in New Orleans a couple of years ago, to help to strengthen, let's say, the dikes and everything around New Orleans to get the people not the same experience they had back, this dramatic experience actually, a couple of years ago when the whole part of New Orleans was flooded. So this is where we can help. This is a business model for Netherlands. We also help, for instance, in the Middle East. If you look at those islands we have there, this is also something being done from our companies in Netherlands. So this is something we're very proud of. Yeah, it's just, as I mentioned, it's the center of the world, and maybe you can see it better, but I really think it's the center of the world. We took it a little bit bigger. This is the Netherlands. And if you take the US, then you would say, how can you fight on such a small part? How could you fight? Rotterdam is, let's say, more or less a little bit here, and we are a little bit higher in the middle of the Netherlands. So it's only 100 kilometers. If you then look at the global perspective, then the Netherlands actually is known from innovation, doing stuff differently. This is what we did centuries ago. This is what we still try to do. In the meantime, we, of course, have a lot of nationalities in the Netherlands. We are very open to get new people inside and to also, together with those nationalities, make the Netherlands great again. Like the US said, we are going to be great again. I think we are already great. But we have to also be realistic. There is a lot of things we can also improve. And cooperation in the Netherlands is the most important thing, I would say. If you look at China, those are a couple of statements around the biggest part, but I will tell you later. In Netherlands is export. So a lot of our business is being exported to any country in the world. It's China, it's Germany mainly. If it comes to industry, it's the greater the UK and of course also the US. Some figures. Such a small country, almost 17 million people. And then when I come to Istanbul, for instance, there are living around the same amount of people, and there is the space is even less. So actually, we should never complain about the fact that we have a too small country. We have a good and a very nice country. It's very small. We know it from the flowers and from the clumps. We know it from the water and the rain. But we also know it, let's say, from a country that is proud to move forward, to do things differently. We also have the ability to do so. 16, 17 million people almost. This is, let's say, from last year. So we, in the meantime, we had some additional. So I think we are now around 17 million. After the crisis about 7 years ago, we are now climbing up. We are having a growth. The GDP is around 650 billion euros. And every year it comes in the next 2 years ahead, 3 years ahead, we are aiming for 2-3% growth, which means that, let's say, it all becomes better. And if you then look at the biggest, the most important thing is that you will see on the right side, let's say the southern part of Netherlands, this is the knowledge intensive part of the economy. This is also where the growth is the biggest. So the growth used to be in the harbors, in the harbor sites, but now it's moving towards, let's say, knowledge intensive industries, meaning big OEMs like ASML, but also I'm talking about companies like NXP, both parts from Philips, 10 years ago, now separate companies. Van der Landen, also a very big company if it comes to logistics globally. So we are very much globally aligned in that matter. The growth in the industry, you will see it's the number three in the if it comes to the different branches. So industry is pretty big. And with about 12% share in the total GDP, it's a lot of business we can do. As mentioned, export, 82 billion euros export only of, let's say, agricultural business, 82 billion euros. So it's tomatoes, it's let's say, all things we develop here. We are making tomatoes, let's say, that really are different for the whole world. And I was told a year ago, again, that we are, I think, at least in the top countries among the globe, to develop new tomatoes. Well, if I tell this to my son, then he becomes very happy because he loves tomatoes. But you know, this is some small thing, but it's very important for us. So the small things for us are very important, and the small steps forward can also be an example to the rest of Europe, to the rest of the world. And we love to do that in that way, not because we are arrogant, but just because we want to make a step forward. And because we are so small, I think we also have, let's say, the possibilities to do so. Talking about growth, this is a slide we normally show for Digital Factory. I'm responsible for Digital Factory in Netherlands. And if you talk about growth, then you talk about how to move forward in the future. We should, let's say, do more with the same amount of people. And if you look at these figures, then Industry 3.0, it was already about 35 years ago, as of that moment, the growth rates declined, actually, in the industry. And this was also the reason why countries like China were able, let's say, to compete with us. So let's say growth is the major driver if it comes to Industry 4.0. And this is when I come to the point of my presentation, where I will, of course, also relate to WinCOA as part of this this future. How can we realize growth? If we look back 1500, we had $500 per capital per capita of production. If you then look back in 2015, this was already 9,000. But I said, okay, you know, it's 500 years. And we increased from $500 to $9,000. But then if you look at this graph, then you will see and find out that in the last, let's say, 150 years, we have made the biggest growth. So meaning that we are improving. But it needs to be improved. It needs to be improved every time. And when we talk to the government, when we talk to the people that are responsible in Netherlands for industry also, then we are continuously focusing on that. Because it's very important. If we want to become, or remain, and also become the leader in Europe, or maybe the world if it comes to new innovations, then we need to move forward. Smart industry is the answer of the Dutch government towards Industry 4.0. And for those who do not know Industry 4.0, it's a German initiative coming from the government, talking about how to move forward in the future. What should we do to compete as Europe against countries that have low cost if it comes to labor? So we in Netherlands, we have made it orange, which is our national color, so that's good, and it's called smart industry. If you look back in the let's say, industrial revolution, then we started with water and steam. Electricity followed, let's say, 1930, and automation started, let's say, late 50s. The first PLC, it was coming out late 60s, something about that, not Siemens. But we gave a good answer if it comes to Siemens to the possibilities, because with C-Matic, of course, we are now in the most parts of the world, we are market leader. The next step is digitalization. And if I talk about digitalization, then I ask all the people here, and I get twice as many answers to this topic that we are here together. Maybe more than 500 answers. What is digitalization? What is digitalization about? Because automation, we already had back in the 70s. Yeah, it's not zero and one. This is not the answer to the question, what's digitalization? Because zero and one we already had back in the 70s. Maybe even end of the 50s we already had that. So digitalization is something different. Digitalization means that we are going to connect the stuff, we're going to communicate among to make it more effective. Very easy said. Industry 4.0 will take the cost of skill close to zero. So when I talk to, for instance, a big brewery in Holland, then they tell me, you know, in 5 years from now, we want to be able to make beers, let's say, one by one, for the same amount of money that you are paying now a mass consumption for. And this is a big challenge, because, you know, if you want to change over every second, then your system needs to be flexible, and it needs to be adjustable. It needs to actually think for itself. It needs to understand, okay, now I need to make something different. And this is where also WinCOA comes in. Because, you know, if you want to change in such a small amount of time, then you need software, and software is the driver for the future. The driver for the future. It's not like that we are only going to sell software in the future, because the hardware will always be there. Maybe less than today, but there will always be hardware. But software will be the main value add for the future and will make the difference if it comes to the future. The answer of Siemens towards the Industry 4.0 is actually Digital Enterprise Software Suite, which you will see here. And very simple said, we will integrate the virtual world and the real world. Meaning that, for instance, we are going to build a boat, a ship. This ship will first of all be developed. Yeah? And before it's even built, we can already virtual test it. Meaning that if Titanic, for instance, would never have sailed out of Southampton in 1914, what was it, 1912, when we would have had this software. Because then at that moment we could, during the virtual testing, already have concluded that the watertight doors were not high enough. The reason for the sinking of Titanic in the end. So before you're going to build something, you're going to, let's say, develop it, like a digital twin, as we call it, virtual real. You're going to develop it, you're going to virtual test it, and then if everything is okay, the next step is to build it. That's the first big benefit, because it saves money, it saves time. The second benefit is, let's say, that the continuous optimization of this process means that, let's say, this system needs to be integrated. So the virtual and the real world needs to be merged, needs to be together. And if this circle is closed, you can use data to optimize the system, like in a Formula One car. And we are very proud in Holland with Max Verstappen in the meantime. Also, our software helps Max Verstappen in the Red Bull Racing Formula One car to become better every day, every second of the day. I was told it's about 10,000 changes a day in such a car. Well, I can tell you, if you need to do it from our head, with our hands, forget about it. It will not happen. So those cars, let's say, are continuously optimized by data that comes back from the car, from the environment, to optimize the car in this way, both from production perspective, but also in the racing environment. So this will be an integration, and it will also help us if it comes to innovation. And then I say, people ask me, what about China? I said, if we are able to innovate faster than China can copy, or Asia can copy, then we will always be leading. It's not about the innovation. We have a lot of ideas. But how can you make those ideas realistic? And therefore, you need an integrated technology chain. And this is what we at Siemens are aiming for. And this is what we are working on together with you all. Two short examples from Wins COA, a very big, I think the biggest one in Europe, gas regulation, GasUnie. In the northeast part of the Netherlands, we have the so-called brown gold, meaning that we get a lot of gas from, let's say, from the ground. There are currently many discussions because there are. It also means that there are a lot of earthquakes around because you're taking a lot of gas out of the ground. But at this moment, GasUnie is still a big customer for us, and specifically for Wins COA. So it's a very important one. The only way to make this possible with Wins COA, to make it possible, what with Wins COA, because of the big plant we're talking about, the big system we're talking about. So this is specifically something for Wins COA to be applied for. Another one is Delftland. And I told you already that in many parts of the Netherlands, we are below sea level. And there, the Wins COA application helps us to make the people safer, to make the environment safer. Because we need to regulate the level of water in this area of 40,000 people. So we use the Wins COA to make sure that people are not getting flooded. So it's a very important application, both from social perspective and also technology perspective. So I think that Wins COA is, in that matter, absolutely the best solution for us we could imagine. I will not focus on mobility references because the colleagues will tell you in the next 2 days already about that. These were just two short examples. This one is not an example specifically for a WinC application, but it meant the start back in 2007 for ETM and Siemens. At this moment, we are building, like you know, in the London Eye, the big wheel we see in London. They're also building this in New York. It's called the New York Wheel. It's about 200 meters high, and it has about 35,000 aimed for daily visitors. This is a Dutch consortium making this Dutch with this New York Wheel. And specifically, New York is something where we are really having a connection with, because a couple of centuries ago, New York used to be Dutch. It was called New Amsterdam, and we sold it for $1, I think. And I don't think this is the best business case we ever had. But I think, you know, New York is a great city. I'm always happy to come in New York. And building this from a Dutch consortium is something to be proud of. And we are proud of that. And also New York was the starting point, as mentioned, for ETM and Siemens. And you will also get back on that with your introduction back in 2007. So there's a close connection between Amsterdam and New York, New Amsterdam, Amsterdam. There's a close connection to between Siemens and Siemens Netherlands and ETM. And hopefully, in the end of the day, we will also have a close connection with each other. And I also hope that you will enjoy Amsterdam, although I'm not the biggest fan of Amsterdam. I hope, of course, that you will have a nice time. And I wish you all prosperity and all good luck. And before I stop, I would like to hand over. And this slide, I think it's the last one, is something. If you come to New York in the next years ahead, please visit. It will be opened in 2017, this year, somewhere in September, and it's great. It's true, and it's great. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Frick, for welcoming us in your home country, for that great speech, for that great introduction to the Netherlands. I think we're all delighted to be here in Amsterdam this year. Let me introduce now our next keynote speaker. This year, ETM celebrates its 10th year with Siemens. So let's go on a journey through time with him. Therefore, please welcome with me our CEO, Mr. Bernhard Reichli.
Hello. A warm welcome also from my side to the WinCCOA User Days 2017 here in Amsterdam. Frank told you already the story I want to tell you. Maybe now you, all of you know, but maybe some minutes ago you did not, some of you did not know. We were not always with Siemens as ETM. It's exactly 10 years from now on that Siemens acquired ETM. And maybe you ask, why did Siemens acquire ETM? Already 10 years ago, there were several very well-established HMI, SCADA, and DCS products available at Siemens. And the reason Siemens acquired us was and is a very simple one. And it's, I think, the same reason why many of you are now WinCCOA customers. 10 years ago, Siemens was looking for an extraordinary SCADA system with many thousands or millions of decks handling many, I would say, hundreds of servers and so on. Maybe I should switch to this slide here. And there was a very specific reason Siemens was looking for a SCADA system. This was exactly the project Frank already mentioned, the New York Metro, the passenger information system. And there, Siemens decided for WinCCOA. And, you know, it's Siemens, and so they did not license WinCCOA, as you normally do. Siemens just acquired us. This was the more simple way for them to get us. And with this project, the success story of WinCCOA within Siemens started. I want to show you an additional example. Since we are here in Netherlands, the project Gasunie, Frank already mentioned it. There we have also a lot of very interesting key features. The ability to high standardization, you can see it outside in the mini fair, and the long-term compatibility. Gasunie started with us, I think, in 2004 or 5 or something like that, and can upgrade WinCCOA since many years and will do it with a long-term contract with them for the next years. The image looks quite simple, similar to the image with New York, but in this case, the lines are not metro lines. These are the gas network of Gasunie, a countrywide SCADA system. Let's go back to Siemens and our history with them. Often, small companies suffer when they are acquired by big companies. But somehow, Siemens and we did it quite well. I'm a little bit proud to tell you that not only WinCCOA profits from being with Siemens, but also Siemens takes a lot of advantage from WinCCOA. For instance, we use the international sales network of Siemens and combine it with our software sales know-how. We share a lot of technical experience, and maybe you know that the headquarters of WinCCOA in Eisenstadt, Austria, is also the Siemens Competence Center for developing runtime platforms. And we support our partners together with the Siemens colleagues in the regions. let me show you some indications of our common success. When we were acquired by Siemens, we were 58 WinCCOA specialists. Today, we are around about 150 employees. 10 years ago, we had 18 WinCCOA partners. Today, we have a network of 149 certified WinCCOA solution partners and OEM partners. And our revenue grew by nearly a factor of 4 within the last 10 years. I think this is quite a success. So let me end with a short outlook for the next years. We will continue to focus on the infrastructure market. Listen to Bernd Stauffer, who will be, I think, the next. He will give you also a story how digitalization can be combined with infrastructure. And we will put a lot of energy in winning and convincing new software OEMs that use WinCCOA as their platform in their applications. And we want to become much stronger in the US and in China. These are huge markets where WinCCOA today is not as present as I like. And how will we achieve these goals? Very simple. We will make WinCCOA the best SCADA product in the world. Have fun these days, and thank you very much.
Many thanks to you, Bernhard, for this insight about the development of ETM and WinCCOA. Now let's see some recent achievements and welcome somebody on stage who is the best person to answer this question. He's our Director of Marketing and Sales. Listen for yourself. Now he will tell us about the highlights since our last user days. Please give a warm applause to Bernd Stauffer.
Yeah, me again. Thank you. Almost so traditionally, I would love to tell you what happened since the last user days, 2016 in London, pretty much precisely a year ago. So let's have a look back. Like my boss said, the success story continues. We had last year, over the year before, a growth on volume of 18 points. This is precisely three times more than the average market growth for SCADA worldwide. So we're hitting apparently here really a spot with our product and have a phenomenal growth. Seeing that as a part of the total SCADA portfolio from Symatic and Siemens, WinCCOA represents already almost 25% of the total worldwide volume with our three SCADA products. And it's not because WinCCOA alone is growing. The whole SCADA portfolio had an excellent year last year and is also doing very well already this year. And at this point, I'd like to thank all our current and existing partners here in that room for their hard work, for their confidence in our product, and for the success with our product. Now, let's go and welcome a few more solution partners in our family. We were actually able to convince 17 new solution partners and certify them since last year in London to join our WinCCOA family. Most of them, I think, are here, and I really like to welcome them with a big applause. So you see, we're getting serious also on the goal from my boss that we certainly want to grow even faster in two world regions, in US and China. We added also partners here, and we'll still do so in the next year. Also, as usual, I have chosen 6 reference projects, knowing that, of course, you all did much more in the last year. But it wouldn't impossible actually to show all the interesting things you did that would just simply break the time which was given to me to speak today. So I've chosen six, and I've chosen that based basically on knowing that some of you might be interested to talk to those partners who have implemented those projects in the last year. Let's start in the US. A new partner, Solid State Automation, which we could convince a year before, actually was doing a very nice oil and gas project, which is a crude oil storage facility in salt caverns, a natural salt caverns, which hold 20 million barrels of oil. And it's a fully Siemens-equipped installation, from redundant PLCs to redundant Siemens industrial PCs, of course, with a central OA system and a lot of nanobox servers also running WinCCOA in a distributed system. So that's really a perfect showcase on how to automate and control a project in oil and gas. So I know Solid State will be here later on stage showing another project which they also realized, but the guys are here. If you're interested, don't hesitate, talk to them. The next thing is, like, you discovered already with the way we like this kind of mega projects, and that's the reason, because the product fits to this kind of projects also. Not only, but also. So we're also very proud, actually, in Turkey last year, there was a project which actually was the automation of the fourth longest suspension bridge in the world, which spans on the highway between Izmir and Istanbul over the so-called Izmit Bay. It's almost 3 kilometers suspension bridge, and the highest point is 242 meters. And what our partner Unicom, together with the Siemens team in Turkey, achieved there is actually really putting all the necessary subsystems in place and control it with WinCCOA, which are important, of course, for the structure of the construction, to make sure it gets correctly dehumidified. The whole structure monitoring is done through WinCCOA. Of course, the lightning and things like fire access control and the power management of the bridge. Very nice project and a very nice piece of architecture in Turkey. Building management. We call it building management. Gare de Montparnasse in France is one of the largest train stations in Paris. They have quite a few, but this, I think, is one of certainly the largest one. And our partner Actemium has done for CNF the whole control of energy, the lighting in the train station, all the escalators, elevators, temperature control, the access controls of entrance and exits, and many more subsystems. It was done, of course, with a redundant server pair and Oracle long-term historian. So very nice, and I think a very safe train station now in Paris. Let's go a little bit further away. Let's go to Peru, to Lima. Our colleagues from Siemens Mobility, rail electrification actually, had done a very nice project. The line 2 and the line 4 of the Metro Lima were building a new electrification SCADA system, including 37 power supply stations, 21 rectifier stations, an overall system using a so-called disaster recovery system. So it's actually a 2x2 redundant system, and it's a sealed 2 installation. All the communication there was standardized on S7 and IC104. I think that was just the first step there. There are more lines in Lima, and I'm very confident that we also will make the other lines and automate the other lines electrification. What is next? Next is, again, one of those European mega projects. It is, per definition, the longest train tunnel in the world with 57 kilometers, going underneath the Gotthard Alpine Massif. And why do I bring it up here? Because it finally is operational. There is already train traffic running through the tunnel since the 11th of September of last year. That was the date where they really started to operate after many years of work. And that project also was done by Siemens Mobility for a major part, but there was also many other partners, system integrators in Switzerland, such as JM Systems and others, participating also with a lot of subsystems, which they put in. So that was not only a Siemens thing, that was only really a joint work with a lot of subsystems with many WinZ COA partners. Yeah, same here. It's, of course, a redundant tunnel control system with many, many hundreds, thousands of tags and disaster recovery configuration. There's also a 2x2 configuration with an Oracle long-time historian cluster. And the interesting thing here, the customer decided actually very early in the project to standardize all communication to the devices based on OPC UA. I think which was a very wise decision and very helpful for a correct implementation of that project. And due to the openness of WinZ COA, Siemens and other partners were also able to integrate several other third-party software applications doing other tasks than SCADA. Another one very close to here, I think it's almost a walking distance. It's a tunnel, brand new. It was just opened in May 2007. It's the Spandammer tunnel. I hope I spell it correctly. Thank you, my colleagues nod. There was a central control system with about 20,000 data points. It's a redundant pair of servers, and it's all done, of course, with Siemens hardware as well. So also a nice project. The interesting thing was, and it shows that we really get international with the business, this was realized, in that case, not by a Dutch system integrator, but by a German one, a company called Osmo. All right, with that, I'm done with regards to what happened in the last 12 months since we met last time in London. Now let me spend a few words about totally integrated automation in the digital enterprise. Frick spoke already about what digitalization means, and probably from, you said, 250 people, you will get 500 answers how they interpret digitalization. I think you hit the point pretty well that we start to connect the human and our devices for the good of becoming better. What drives actually the need for digitalization and for building digital enterprises? And we strongly believe it's those four requirements. It is speed. It is speed to produce things faster. It is speed to shorten the life cycle from the first idea to the launch of a product in the market. But it's also speed to make infrastructure projects faster than in the past. And by that, of course, the customers expect that we still be even more flexible than in the past. Things like build to order or even build to configuration, such as the car industry is going that road where there's this manufacturing belt, but every model which runs on the belt is already customized by you when you're typing in your configurator how you like to have your car. So who is handling that? Software is handling, actually, and giving this flexibility. And it's the same again in infrastructure, that your customers expect you to build the system exactly to their needs, but to keep a certain flexibility to change it when it's necessary with regards to their installation or installation is growing. And under no way, and that's point number three, we should hamper the quality on what we're doing here. So we should make them faster, we should make them more flexible, and ideally, we should do that at even a higher quality as in the past. And also here, software is the answer to help here. And overall, at the end, it should be even more efficient what we're doing and the way we're doing it. And don't forget that the overall thing is security, because what is in those data of a plant or of an infrastructure, of a critical infrastructure installation, is the IP of the customer, of your partner, is his domain know-how, is his value of his company. And that needs to be secured, of course, on with regards to IT security. So those are the four demands, and overall, we have to make sure that we don't compromise on security. So how are we going to do that? Probably most of you are working with Siemens already a while know this. The digitalization and integration in the entire value chain is what also Frank said we believe is the competitive edge. Is it to make sure we differentiate ourselves from maybe China as a market, but also from our competitor, maybe locally. So what are the phases here? The phase is like, I have an idea and I start a product design. And once I've done that, I want to go into production planning. I want to go in the engineering. But it includes, of course, the virtualization, the digital twin, all these kind of buzzwords today. And once you have done all that and you have simulated in a virtual environment, then you start the execution of the production. And one of the longest circles, certainly, is the service part. So think about that whole value chain. Typically, the car industry brought down the development of a new car average from about 4 years down to less than 2 years, from the design of the model to really the market launch. It's enormous, and they're still driving to become faster, speed, you remember? So how are we going to do that? Siemens, in the last 10 years, acquired more than 20 software companies. And not only in the pure field of the production execution of the automation, like ETM with the SCADA system. No, starting already with product design tools, simulation tools, virtual commissioning tools. One of the last acquisitions just a few weeks ago was Mentor Graphics, a company with worth of a business volume of 1.2 billion with about 4,500 employees. Just to complete this portfolio, and Siemens at that point, with those more than 20 companies, is probably today the only company in the industrial area which have already a solution to those five steps in the value chain. The Digital Enterprise Suite, and Frank also touched upon this, so this is actually the products for the product lifecycle management, so for the design phase, for the production planning phase, for the testing phase, and then you come to the operational part, management operation, manufacturing operation management software, and of course, everything we need for the totally integrated automation, automation hardware, SCADA systems as such, etc. So that's what we call an enterprise suite. Of course, you understand that this is not one product I buy. This is a whole bunch, a whole set of products which I can apply today according to the needs of the industry and the customer. But now let's focus in a bit on the digital enterprise, on the TIA, on a total integrated automation. What's the key message here? So we think it's like the TIA portal is the gateway to the automation in the digital enterprise. What does that mean? To have really a platform, a tool where I can go from the panel to the PLC to a SCADA system to really build that automation part within a digital enterprise. Now you might say, well, it's great and we understand that, and probably one of you have heard about that already. And some of you are here, of course, in the manufacturing arena, are having enterprises, are working hard already to get a digital enterprise out of that. But a very large part of the audience here is actually dealing in the infrastructure market. And you might ask yourself, so what does that have to do, actually, over the infrastructure? Well, I would say, first of all, see the term digital enterprise is a synonym for digitalization within our industries we touch upon with Siemens and with our partners. But there is more to that. So if we now focus and zoom in on that part of digital workflow, integrated engineering, and what we call the production phase, and the services. So the blue parts actually are the ones where factory automation delivers solutions, while the green parts are coming from our product lifecycle management colleagues with all those nice products like Teamcenter or Annex. Let's focus on the factory automation part, where you're all familiar. So now we go really into the mainly manufacturing world. And in the manufacturing world, there's a position clearly within Siemens, and most of you have seen that either in speeches from myself or from some of my local Siemens colleagues, that those three products we have today, WinCC version 7, WinCC version 14, and WinCC Open Architecture, are somehow basically positioned that the first two are mainly focused with a feature set on a manufacturing, while OA is mainly focused on the infrastructure market or on software OEMs. And I say mainly because, of course, there are always exceptions when needed. So if we stay with the left part, with the manufacturing portfolio, then I think the chart here shows very well that you have this total integrated automation portal, a TIA portal, and to use that, ideally in a manufacturing world, the WinCC TIA SCADA product and that current version of V14 and 15 coming up would be the choice, actually, in going really into building a real manufacturing factory. And again, there are exceptions, and therefore a good reason exception as well, but this is the main idea. So totally integrated automation in a real digital enterprise would mean the TIA portal and the corresponding SCADA version. And you see where I'm already driving. I'm driving towards the SCADA part again, back to our user days here. So how does that look like now for the infrastructure part? Yes, there is also digitalization need in the infrastructure management. It might be different. Yes, an infrastructure management solution might not need an overall equipment efficiency module or a scheduler, but it will need certainly other things as well to make sure that also my infrastructure management installation will be a state-of-the-art digitalized kind of enterprise. So, and for this, we see clearly also the chance to use the TIA portal, because we want, of course, to make sure that our customers use also our hardware, our PLCs, our panels to be engineered, of course, very nicely with a totally integrated automation portal, with a TIA portal, but also use then this very specific SCADA system with all the high feature set for infrastructure, which is in this case WinCC OA. So I think you understand here the basic where I'm driving towards. Both needs digitalization with slightly different requirements when it comes down to the feature set of the SCADA system, but when it comes again on the automation layer, also here the TIA portal is an option. So that's why now we want to see the chart this way, that we said yes with regards to the SCADA part, with regards to the OA part as platform. Yes, we have a solution for simulation, for commissioning, and instead of production, I would love to call that important step infrastructure management. This is actually what a big part of you as our solution partners really implement in your day-to-day work. Now, what is the portfolio of WinCC OA supporting this digitalization? What are the features we either have today or we are working on, and we'll tell you during the morning more about? So in that engineering phase, you can expect that we have, of course, also for WinCC OA, something which is called TIA export. So whatever was engineered for the PLCs, you don't have to do again. You just will use it. You will just import that engineering part into WinCC OA and continue using it there as well. There is a great product, a great software product, which is called Simit from Siemens, which is actually a simulation tool which you can online or offline simulate, means with PLCs or without PLCs, actually already simulate and test what you did together with WinCC OA. So these both products connect very nicely to each other. We have something which is called an advanced playback manager, which allows you to go in a historian and playback situations which happened during your real operation for various reasons. Also to learn about when you want to change things in the engineering process in the future. And of course, the general openness of WinCC OA will allow actually to adapt the product towards your preferred engineering process according to your demand. So that's in that phase. What do we have now during the transparent operation phase? Here we'll hear a few more things that we're working on to put WinCC OA on a very interesting piece of hardware from Siemens, which is called the IoT 2040 industrial single board PC. We're right now working very hard because this seems to us a very, very great solution as an IoT device, as a very rather low-cost IoT device running WinCC OA, and to put out there as gateway, as data collector. There are various use cases we can imagine. Lucas, our product manager, will tell you more also about the MQTT driver. We are constantly working to increase and improve our mobile UIs, our UI solutions. And again, also here, we have the openness of the product with regards to, yes, you can customize, you can make exactly what your customer requires. You have no real limits. And in the last phase, and please don't forget, the service phase is usually the one where we would lose customers. You lose probably a deal, a tender, whatever, but at that moment it's not yet your customer. Then you do the project, and usually everything's very professional, it goes very well, the customer is happy. But the most dangerous is actually the service phase, because that's the longest where the customer uses actually our products and your solutions. So if we mess up here, then those customers might not come back. And I think also here we have already today a lot of things available and in mind what we like to do to make our offer even better to support you and the customers during the service phase. And one of that things is SmartSCADA. We introduced the version 1 last year. It's out in the market, and Lucas will tell you more about what is coming next within SmartSCADA. MindSphere, I think MindSphere is the industry cloud or the industry cloud solution from Siemens. And here, of course, we will also have what is called a MindSphere connector, so that from your SCADA system, WinSys UA, as well as also from our other SCADA systems from Siemens, you will be able to put selected data into this cloud solution. And we have something which is called Advanced Maintenance Suite since many years, which actually ties very nicely into the SCADA system using the alarm information for troubling ticketing and running actually your maintenance team. So we covered today already a lot of those features which allow digitalization and infrastructure, and we'll come up with even more. With that, I'm at the end of my speech, and I hope to have a lot of discussions about and around these topics with you in the next 2 days. With that, I'd like to thank you for your attention and hand back to Martina. Thank you.
Facts and figures coming from Bernd. Thank you very much for that. I hope the stories you heard about were inspiring for you. And the next item on our agenda will be the coffee break. And maybe you can discuss one or the other topics with us and other participants. Also, please, you can visit the mini fair outside. You have already seen and I've introduced to you. And the coffee break will be in this area as well as in the first floor. So there is enough space for all of us to enjoy the coffee break. We will be meeting here again in about 20, 25 minutes. And to continue with our keynote speech from our product management and development team. So enjoy your coffee. Until then, see you there. I hope you are refreshed from the coffee break and you're ready to plunge into the technical part of our keynote speech. Let us see which news our product manager is bringing us today. And it's not exaggerated at all to say that they are the very latest news. Please welcome our product manager, Lucas Schopp, with me on stage.
Thanks. Thanks, Martina. Thanks, all, to be here in Amsterdam. I have talked to someone in the break. It's my sixth user days as a product management here. And as well, as Bernd has already shown, that there was a growth in ATM. We also had the growth in the product management. 5 years ago, it was a more or less one-man show. And up to now, yeah, we are at three people team. So we also get more and more growth on the product management part. So maybe just in that. Yeah, I will show you together with Elizabeth today the technical part and new features and stuff about WinSys UA. We have split this in three parts. At first, I will bring an update on the current version 3.15. Yeah, we have released the 3.15 in January. Then we have a part where we say research, development, and security topics. So what is our current research topics we see as a vision for the next years? Yeah. And then we go to the next version 3.16 features and the roadmap and see when which is coming. So, the updates. The version 3.15 we released with some of our great ideas of our OU panels, so the object-oriented panels, but we brought them in a beta status. So you have been able to test it, to work with it, but it was not officially released for operational. That is one of our ideas we had since 3.14, to bring features as soon as possible to you, so you can try, give us feedback, and then when we bring it to the official release, we can optimize that with your feedback. We have done this with object-oriented panels. We have told you that we will bring JavaScript widgets to WinCC UA. It was not released with the version. We talked that will be with the next patch. Then we have not released Windows Server 2016, and we told you, yeah, we will do the BugNet certification. And I can give an update on that part that we will bring the OO panels in an official release with the next patch, patch 3, end of May. We will bring JavaScript as well, as we have done this with our continuous delivery idea, as a beta version to the product in the next patch. So you can try that, you can work with it, you can give us feedback, what is missing, what you want to have, until we have the official release for that. We will support Windows Server 2016, and with the next patch, patch 4, yeah, we will bring the BugNet certification. That's the update from 3.15, and then, as every year, we ask in our update trainings, what are the two best features in the new version? Yeah, and out of all these hundreds of feedbacks on that part, we considered the five best features from the 3.15. So we have Control++ and OOPS, where we will have a great workshop tomorrow from Todd Malone. We have layout management enhancements, Smart SCADA, and the S7 Plus driver as the five big new topics in the 3.15. And for Smart SCADA, we have prepared a really nice marketing video. You will be the first people to see it. It's brand new. It's not officially released, so we will make some small adjustments, but I want really to show this. I can't wait. So I will show you the Smart SCADA video now.
Getting the most out of your plants or applications requires making the right decisions. Efficiency, performance, and availability depend upon many factors. Most of them influence each other and make it challenging to determine new potentials and how to realize them. Measured values, estimates, and statistics can help or increase confusion. Often, cause and effect are too far apart. However, decisions should best be based on facts. Finding the needle in the haystack is much easier with WinCC OA Smart SCADA. It allows you to assess your plant or application with KPIs and statistical tools that help you make the right decisions and to continuously optimize your business. It is industry independent and can be used for any application, like wind power plants, power supply systems, or large production plants. For example, WinCC OA Smart SCADA can be used to analyze the generators of a wind power plant. By comparing the performance data of the generators, it is easy to spot deviations that may cause problems. That behavior could be caused by wear and lead to failure. WinCC OA Smart SCADA uses three ways to analyze the data of your plant or application. They can be used separately, but provide deeper insights when used in combination. First, the KPI Wizard allows easily setting up the calculation expression for devices, for calculating the efficiency of each device. It then displays the results and clearly shows if any device performs differently from the others. Data mining comes of use when the source of an error is not obvious. This means that not only current, but also historical data are being analyzed. in order to find correlations and dependencies between different process values. This can help to recognize patterns that indicate the cause of problem that could not be seen by only looking at single KPIs. By classifying the data, an expert can link the results and use automatic recognition of states in order to generate statistical models. Based on real-time data, an expert can label patterns that indicate the behavior of components. Recurring states can easily be identified by these patterns to generate knowledge. WinCC OA Smart SCADA can be used on a single station for smaller plants or applications. Or by using the analytics server, it can be scaled up easily to analyze any amount of data coming from large infrastructures. WinCC OA Smart SCADA. Easy, scalable, and industry independent.
Thank you. Yeah, let's come to the topic about research development topics. I start with some things what we have started, I think 3 or 4 years ago. What we say, during the user days, during the workshops or the partner presentation in the afternoon, we want to get your feedback on our software to improve the usability. We have done that in the last years with a lot of different ideas and features. And the important part is that we need to get the feedback from to our design, to our workflow, how the engineering is working within WinCC UA. We want to have the user experience from you. And this year, for example, we have the focus on the engineering workflow. So for all people who are going to the usability test today, we will not do an classic usability test like the last years where you are sitting in front of the PC and doing some tests. This year, we want to know from you your engineering workflow. So you are really in that part where you can tell us how you would love to engineer your facility, your SCADA system. So you're free to give us the impression how you want to work so we can improve our engineering that you can do that in a faster way. Maybe just an example what we have done last year. Last year we have done that on the device management for our mobile UIs. Mobile UIs and desktop UIs, and this also the class, the device class configuration. And we brought up a first prototype how this all can look like. And you gave us a lot of feedback, like, why is this space so big? Is this information needed? Why is this button there? And what is exactly mean with this text field? What should I write there? So we improved all of this information and have done a new design on that part. Yeah. So there are often not the big changes, but the small things as well as, no, I don't want to click and go through all the panel to make all changes. So to fasten up the ways to engineering would help you to make a faster engineering to bring your facility faster on the market. That's the idea behind our usability tests, and this year, focus on engineering. Next topic. I think the most people have already seen where we have done an Industry 4.0 demo with the Fraunhofer Institute. We have this in the mini fair out there, and the idea was it should have a modern look and feel. It should work on the mobile devices as well as in the combination of mobile devices, because we think that the people will have mobile devices in their plants, in their infrastructure things, and all over. So we said we want to see how all this works together. And you can go out there and see this demo out there. And the interesting part now, last year, I told you that we are investigating on push notifications. That's a research topic, and we started that, okay, it would be nice if someone is getting a push notification if an alarm or event is driven on the plant. But we see after a while that that's not really all what we could do in the future. There's much more currently out there in the world. So we started with one of my students, a master's thesis on that topic. What is modern communication, notification topics, and how could these be used within a SCADA system? So not only you get alarms, no, you can also communicate with your facility. So you can ask the facility questions. Give me more information. Don't just open the UI and find the right thing. You can say, without opening the UI, for example, in any of these traditional and common use apps like WhatsApp or Telegram or Skype or something like that, you can communicate with your facility. That's done with a so-called notification bot, chatbots. Yeah, that's a new way for communication. And our master thesis is based on the Microsoft bot framework, so we have a bunch of new communication ways on that part. And we built a WinCCOA notification bot. So what is that? Therefore, we have a live demo. Hopefully the internet is all fine. Yeah. What is the setup? I have set up here on the PC our Industry 4.0 demo. So we have four machines simulated locally here. I have the plant server here running, and this PC will be the manager PC. And then we have there my colleague Jürgen. He is the maintenance operator guy with the iPad. He is somewhere out in the facility and doesn't know that something will happen. And he's connected with his iPad via Skype, via the internet, to our notification bot. I'm, as manager, I'm connected with my phone and my watch to the notification bot via Telegram. And now let's see what will happen when one of the machines has a failure. So I have all the four machines here. As you see, as you see on the right side, I have all four machines, and I have the management view. Yeah, the people, so we switched just positions, yeah, so. All are fine, all in standby. They are connected, nothing happens. When I now say, okay, I would produce a failure, so I disconnect this machine from the whole factory. We get a message from coloring machine one shutdown. Please investigate. Yeah? He is somewhere in the facility, does not know where to go, so he has the choice to get information, for example, and get the information from... The message is going through the whole bot server, is coming to WinCCOA and is like, okay, I want to have more information about line two. So I'm sending, the system sends automatically the serial number, the line, where is it located, which model, so he knows exactly which things, which tools he should grab to go to the facility and find out what is the problem. On the way, he says, okay, I will investigate on that machine, I will take care of about. So he will say, investigate, acknowledge. So the alarm is acknowledged, he will do something with that. I, on the management view, I see currently it's just offline. I don't know what happens really. So he's now there on in the machine place and say, okay, I cannot repair it in a fast way. I think it's broken. So I sent the facility, it's broken. What happens? I, on the management view, see, okay, the coloring machine is in error state. So it's really broken. Now I could drag and drop it out and say, okay, I take another coloring machine because I need to produce something, or he tells me, ah, it's okay, I need 10 minutes, then it's, I can repair it. So he's now doing his magic, yeah, and repairs the machine and tells the system, okay, the machine is repaired. So on the management level, I see it's offline, but when I'm not there, I don't know this exactly. So what is now happening? I got through Telegram a notification, and it tells me machine coloring machine 1 is operational again. So what should happen? Should he connect the machine again to the line, or should he don't connect that? I say connect. So I say to the system, connect to the facility, and he gets the message, okay, connect the machine again. Now I'm doing that on the part and say, he's on the machine and say, okay, I try to connect. He's now trying to connect the machine. The machine is now connecting to the plant server, says, okay, I'm a coloring machine, I'm in line 1, and all this magic, what you can see out there in the mini fair. Yeah? And as well as sometimes, if all the information are exchanged, the system says, okay, I'm connected, I'm here, and on the management level, I see all fine, all standby, so I can say, okay, I want to have produced this thing, this block, and I see that the line 1 cutting machine starts production. That's, I think that's a really cool thing on that part where I say, okay, he does not need to start the WinCCOA user interface again as a maintenance guy on that part, just to find out what is the problem. He will start the user interface again to connect, to make some configuration, to make some settings. But the first step information, that is done via other tools. And yeah, I'm sure every one of you says, okay, what if now the bot which is running somewhere in the cloud loses the connection to my plant? Then I don't get any message from there. Therefore, it's built in the prototype. When I now disconnect the control manager who has all this communication stuff, and I say, okay, stop. So I will stop now the communication to the cloud. The cloud has a lifetime out more or less to see, okay, is it just a network problem, or is it really not connected to the system, or is there any problem? And then he's checking all the systems, and then it's getting information, oh, disconnected. And I also get this message, for example, also on my watch. Yeah. And as well to show that's not a fake, I connect this again, and then it tells me that this is now reconnected and all is fine, and I can work again. So that's the idea, that's a vision, how we think, how the communication, how the workflow will be in some years in our SCADA business for all that. That is part of the master thesis of one of my students, and I think it's a great insight for you to see on which things we are working. Yeah? That's also the topic of digitalization and all that. What is the next step? Yeah. So that is interesting part, I think, to show you on what we are working on the research topics here. And that's not all. There was more information. The next topics about research and development, security topic, I will hand over to Elizabeth Bacchany, director of WinCCOA.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Lucas. You are so brave to do all this online and live. A very warm welcome also from my side. My name is Elizabeth Bacchany. I'm responsible for WinCCOA development and consulting. And regarding research, you could follow over the last years and the user days how Smart SCADA evolved from a pure research project that we did together with Siemens Corporate Technology into a brand new module in WinCCOA. Tomorrow you can join Jürgen Maat, who is here, you can see here this gentleman, and Daniel Schall from Siemens Corporate Technology. Can you quickly wave? He's there in the back. On their workshop on Smart SCADA, which is called Seamless Data Analytics in WinCCOA. They will show you what is available right now in the product and how the roadmap is going to look like. Another research topic that I was reporting last year is our activities around NoSQL databases. Currently, we are working on a prototype together with CERN, and in parallel, we are evaluating a number of databases to see how these databases can suit our requirements, requirements of a SCADA system. So I will tell you more about this, and I will also talk about security and how we are constantly investing to improve WinCCOA regarding security aspects. But you, as an integrator or service provider or asset owner, also have to take appropriate actions regarding security. And I will come to that in a couple of minutes. Yeah, let me quickly wrap up on why we are looking into newest database technology. Well, first of all, we want to support a seamless and smooth migration from local storage to cloud-based storage. Then, of course, scalability is really important, from very low-end hardware to big dedicated servers, from very few data to really, really big data. The picture that I showed on my previous slide here reflects one of CERN's detectors called ALICE. And in ALICE, we need to collect 100,000 values changing 20 times per second. So this yields to over 20 million value changes per second on more than 100 WinCCOA systems, so pretty distributed. But you can imagine that you require really performant and scaling and distributed data processing infrastructure with many, many processors. Another key motivation many customers already told me today even is cost of licensing for databases, for Oracle in specific. Let me say that most NoSQL databases are open source and they do not require expensive dedicated servers. And also customers came to us and said, we would like you to support some different database than Oracle. Many different databases were named. So altogether, we came to the conclusion that we not only want to look at NoSQL databases, but also should look how we can make our whole archiving infrastructure more flexible. What you see here reflects the current prototype that we're working on together with CERN. We have a data manager. The data manager is here, that handles the archive config and initializes the other managers. So this should look familiar to you. Then we have a front-end manager who does WinCCOA-specific stuff like building up queries and doing the smoothing of the data. And then, and this is quite a change, we have one or several back-end managers here. In this example, in the prototype, we have three of them. So this gives us completely new possibilities. First of all, you can define different data sets and have them stored in different databases in parallel. You can say the same data point should be stored in more than one database. And as you can see here, you can decide to use different databases in the background within one WinCCOA system. All these managers are independent processes, so you can either run them on one hardware or distribute them over several ones. So this offers a lot of new possibilities. The communication between front-end and back-end managers is realized by Protobuf, which is a very fast binary XML type of format. We use this so that we can support different programming languages for back-end and front-end. Many NoSQL databases have Java interfaces, and we mainly program in C++. So this is the background. What can this prototype do today? Well, of course, first thing is we can store and persist data, so archive data, value changes. If the backend is not available, we can buffer these value changes. Then we have a backend for Kudu. We have a backend for MongoDB written in Java. And we have a backend to Oracle that is compatible to the data structure that we have now in WinCCOA. In addition, we have a backend template so that you can easily create additional backend processes, and we can do basic queries on historical data. And the prototype today is running on Windows and Linux as well. This is quite important to look at platform independence right from the beginning of a development. In parallel, we are looking at different databases, NoSQL databases, as well as relational databases, to see how well they suit the requirement of a SCADA system with time series data. We have set up a number of evaluation criteria, and we experimented with these databases to see how well they fit. Of course, a criteria is the licensing issue. I mentioned this already. Other criteria is operating system support, then of course general support, how popular is a particular database, meaning how big is the community in the background, how likely is it that in 10 years from now this database is still available and is maintained and is further developed and has new features. So this is what we call popularity. Then the integration is important to us. Installation, is it possible to have a silent setup that we can hide and integrate in the WinCCOA setup so that you don't have so much work to install it? How is the API? How well does it suit our needs? How is the access to the data? For example, if you want to do some reporting, how can I get the data out of the database? Then data handling is important. I mentioned this already. Of course, we have a lot of time series data, so the database has to be suitable for time series data. How well is the segmentation supported? This means that we can easily export and delete data and report them later. This is quite a difficult topic. Scalability, obviously, is a very key important factor. And how, what tools they provide for maintenance. Are there backup and restore facilities? How is the security handled? And key, of course, is performance, performance, performance. In parallel, we also looked at what the community says on databases. Here at the left, you see a survey from March of this year on the popularity of databases. The top ranked database that is not relational is MongoDB, here at spot five, I think. And at the right, we see a Gartner survey from October 2015. The upper right quarter shows the leaders in the business by completion and how well the database work. And again, MongoDB is well placed in this upper right corner. So to make a long story short, our current favorite regarding NoSQL databases is MongoDB. We managed to get a pretty good performance out of it, also on low-end hardware. By the way, we got it running on a tiny, tiny nanobox, which we are quite proud of. It's suitable for small and large size data. There's a license-free version available, an open source version, and we use that for our prototype and also for the experiments and performance measures that we did. Cloud is naturally supported by MongoDB. I mentioned already low-end hardware also works. It is scalable regarding the amount of data. There's a big, big community behind MongoDB, and there's even commercial support, training, and consulting available. So that looks good. And the multi-purpose structure of this database is also suiting our needs regarding the time series data. Like typical in life, there are a couple of drawbacks as well that I do not want to hide. The scaling can be expensive, meaning that you can easily scale from one node to two nodes to three nodes, but then the next scaling factor is six nodes, so there's a jump in between. Then if you want to provide redundancy, you need three nodes and not only two. Third one can be a really small machine, so I think we can live with that. And there are a couple of facilities that we would need to implement ourselves because they don't come for free with it. But overall, I think we can pretty well live with what we have seen now. The next step is that in June, we plan a meeting with experts on MongoDB together with our specialists, where we want to clarify a few open points and learn even more and in depth about this database. And I would say I can give you an update hopefully at next year's at the user days, so please stay tuned on that topic. Yeah, my second focus today is security. And let me start by telling you about the three typical classical protection goals. One, confidentiality. We have to make sure that the data that are collected and processed in WinCCOA are only accessible to authorized users. To do that, for example, we have to make sure that the communication between the managers is protected by an encryption. Number two, integrity. It is really important that the data that we show and that we send to the PLCs are consistent and are not violated by other people or some incidents. Yeah, so it is very important to keep the data integrity. Third, availability. We have to make sure that data and the system and the resources are available to the users, especially during crises or incidents. Yeah, this is key, and WinCCOA offers a hot standby redundancy on redundant standard hardware, and we also support redundant network connections. So, in principle, these protection goals are covered by the WinCCOA architecture. In addition, we have recommendations for you on how to handle certain security mechanisms in the system. So to support you in reaching the highest possible and required security level, we have security guidelines available with every WinCCOA version. Yeah, with every WinCCOA version, there's such a document, has about 100 pages, and it reflects general information on security and on possible security policies and strategies, but also gives you advice on how to set up, configure your system around WinCCOA. So this also deals with third-party components. Excuse me. Where does the input come for these guidelines? Well, for example, the input comes from the so-called threat and risk analysis that we perform for every WinCCOA version since 2013. What is this all about? Well, basically, for new features in WinCCOA, we sit down with security experts from Siemens together with our developers and we discuss these new features. Yeah? We look at what the possible impact can be of this feature. We see this at the upper right, on human beings, on machine, on money. Are there threats about violations of contracts or things like that? On the other hand, we look at how likely it is that such an impact occurs. And together, these two factors, possible impact and likelihood, define the risk level. Let me give you a very simple example. We implement a new driver and a new protocol. So if the data that we send to the PLCs are corrupted or perturbed, then obviously this can be an impact to human beings or to machines. So we want to be protected against this. How likely is this that this happens? This is discussed in this threat and risk analysis as well, where we see how well we protect our data from this. Is there an appropriate encryption algorithm used? Are strong passwords possible to be used? Are data validated before they sent off? So the more such yes we can say, the lower the probability is that this risk occurs or that this impact occurs and the risk goes down. If the risk is fairly high, then we are discussing with the human security experts how we can reduce the risk, what mitigation countermeasures can we do. For example, implement a stronger encryption algorithm would be a typical mitigation process. And of course, we are putting on deadlines for these tasks, are writing more text in the security guidelines to guide you on how to best use the features that we give you. Besides this threat and risk analysis that we do for every version, we plan a penetration test. We did this last time in 2013 or 14, I think, and we plan one for this summer where, again, security specialists from Siemens are trying to hack up a WinCCOA system that was set up by us according to our own security guidelines. So I'm curious what the findings are going to be, and if there are findings that we need to take care of, we will do and inform you again in the security guidelines. Let me spend a few words regarding IEC 62443. Yeah? This is an international series of standards regarding industrial security. And please note that not all of these documents are final yet. Actually, only a few of these documents are finalized yet. Basically, this series of standards has four parts to it. Part one is a very general one, where metrics, definitions are given, models are described. So this is part one. The second part is all about organization, policies and procedures. For example, also physical security, personal security is tackled there. Whereas part three is rather technology oriented. So here we are all into network segmentation, zones, system architecture, availability, system integrity, confidentiality. So part of these words you heard already today. And then there is part four, and part four is all about the components that are playing in the game of this overall system. So the message is that not only we as product supplier have to take care of certain actions regarding security, but also you as an integrator or as an asset owner are involved. So in the screen here, we see here at the bottom the product supplier targets. We are the product supplier and we have to take care of the standards 4.1 and 4.2. 4.1 is dealing with the security, with the development process regarding security, and part 4.2 is dealing with security features per component. So every product supplier that is involved in a system has to look at these two regulations and these two documents and try to comply. And then building on this product supplier, the system integrator comes into the game. And he has to take care about other parts of this series of standards. 2.4, 3.2, 3.3, 4.3.3, of course, the system integrator draws on the means and tools that we are giving him as a product supplier. Yeah? And on top of this is the asset owner, and he has to make sure that his procedures and policies are complying. Let me give you a very simple example on user passwords and authorization and authentication. We as a product supplier, for example, have to make sure that no hard-coded passwords are involved or left somewhere. And we have to make sure that a user cannot get higher privileges than those that are granted to him. The system integrator, on the other hand, has to make sure that default passwords are changed. Oracle, for example, has default passwords, so you have to make sure that these are changed for your final customer. Then the system integrator has, for example, to make sure that temporary accounts are deleted when they're not used anymore. And then the asset owner has to set up the appropriate policies. For example, he can say, I only support really strong passwords. My passwords have to be changed every 3 months, for example. And of course, a certain procedure has to be set up that if people are leaving the company, we have to make sure that their accounts are deactivated immediately. So, again, the message here is, if you want to achieve a certified industrial automation and control system, many, many stakeholders are involved, and we as product suppliers are dealing with this part here. What are the next steps for WinCCOA? Currently, we plan the following. Regarding part 4.1, this is the development process. I mentioned this already. We would like to get a certification rather soon. Of course, before we do that, we want to make an internal assessment on our process to see if and how big the deficiencies are. But we are pretty confident that there will not be many gaps, because with the threat and risk analysis that we're doing already and regular hacking sessions, we think we are on a very good track regarding these process. The second part is 4.2 that we are looking at. Let me mention that regarding part 4.2, there are four security levels defined, and we as product supplier are targeting in the long run to reach security level 3, okay? And to do that, currently we're looking at the gaps between what the product can do and what this different security level require, and we see how we can close the gaps. Some are probably quick wins, some are conceptual work to be done and a lot of implementation to be done. So from what we can say now, it will take a couple of versions until we can finally apply to the standard security level 3. But we are doing a step-by-step approach, and every version contains already now security improvements, and we are closing gaps in every version of WinCCOA. So this brings me back to the topic features and version planning of WinCCOA. Therefore, back to Lucas. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Thanks, Elizabeth. We're a bit behind schedule and try to go through all that as fast as possible, but not too fast. So, as I have already shown you before, we are asking the two, in every update training and all that, we ask the two best features, but we also have the chance for our customer to write down wishes for features and updates for the next versions. And I've brought some of them with us and clustered them in four parts. In the user interface part, the people, you, our customer, wishes a more modern trend, multiple gestures. We started with gestures, but more and more gestures to have this feeling like a modern tablet user interface, enhanced OOPs and Control++, smart SCADA enhancements, yeah, other databases. I think we have already told you that we are researching on that topic. Yeah, more certification, so OPC UA certification, S7 Plus. There is something missing, so alarming is missing, and also maybe make some nice importer, not just export the data from the TIA portal, make it also really easy to import the information, and then some wishes from roadmap and delivery we had in the last year. So longer release cycles was where we have heard a lot of times. More bug fixes we have heard. Yeah. Features not only in the new version, the new major release, please bring them also to a current existing version so we don't need to upgrade every year for getting new features. And the topic about continuous delivery, I think we are already started that topic, as I have shown you, we bring features in a better version. So that's, I think, a great thing what we already do. So let's go through some of the features for 3.16. JavaScript, I have already told you, we'll do an official release for JavaScript, and it will also work on the mobile devices, so you can make really nice JavaScript widgets, objects with a graphical, nice user interface and use them in all of our user interfaces. Yeah. You can connect directly from the JavaScript to the process image. So there will be in JavaScript be a DP get, a DP set, a DP connect, and all that. So you can write there directly the connection. That's on the JavaScript topic. Trend 2.0. Yes, you told us you want to have modern and nicer trending on the part. We have done a lot of new features for the version 3.16, or we're doing some really nice things. For example, this picture here, right, on the right, it's done with 3.15, so it's already, there are a lot of features there in the trend. You can make it really nice, the trend. You just need to have a nice coloring, for example, but we have much more to see, yeah? A pre-selection trend, for example, I have a live demo for that. Customizing ruler pop-ups, event curve, and customer markings. Yeah, because of the time, I think I will jump over the live demo. Yeah, no? Okay. Not a problem. Okay. So. When I start the trend here, for example, I can have a really nice trend, add some curves, yeah, and see what. That are almost features in 3.15. Yeah. Now we come to the new features for 3.16. The pre-selection trend. What is that? You have now a bigger time range in a preview and can really easily with multi-touch or as well with the mouse, change the time frame of the upper trend with that. Imagine that with on a multi-touch with two fingers. Oh, that's great. Yeah. You can also switch the whole part, for example. Then what we have also done is event curves. So you want to see in the trend, not you don't want to go through and, okay, at 12 o'clock we started the production, what happens there? No, you can now directly set events with markings and information inside the trend. So for example, when we say, here I want to add this trend, I see production start, and I see with a color directly, okay, that was the time where I started the production, and I can now really easily see when the production started and also when it ends. And for example, the next production, the next start. I can get this out of the history. Now I've just done that online, but you browse through the history and see, okay, there was production start, production end. And if you imagine you have multiple trend lines, then you can really easily bring them together to see when was the start of this batch and one of the other line, for example. And one more really interesting and funny thing is we have our ruler pop-up. So when you click in the trend, you get the ruler and you get all the information of all trend lines which are currently there and where you have an point. This was this really nice yellow frame what you can't customize. We had a lot of customers say, we want to customize that. We have some really cool ideas how to do that. And we brought here an feature that you now can customize this ruler pop-up. It will be an own panel, so you can customize and do whatever you want. You can do this on your own. And we have brought one example for here, where this ruler pop-up sticks to the ruler, and you can now move that here, or say, okay, play, and it's going through some seconds and all that. So this is now done with an own ruler pop-up here, what was customized. This was not possible before. This will be now possible for the next version 3.16. Yeah, that was the short live demo. You will see more as well on that part in our update training from our two trainers, from Marcus and Andreas, tomorrow in the workshops. So let's go back. Yeah. Let's go further to the next things. Other user interface, more gestures, more other things, yeah? Yeah, we brought our really cool mobile UI for Android and iOS, yeah? We brought the gesture handling there. But there are way more things what you say, okay, when I'm using my iPad or my Android, I normally have, when I'm going through all my menus and all that. I have some nice animations and possibilities to navigate through all my panels. I want to have that in WinCC UA. That's our panel flipper, we call it. So you can now stick on the panel from the in the panel topology, for example, which is on the left or the right. So the next machine on that example, what I will show you here, and that's a really cool thing. So I've animated that. So please have a look to the nice iPhone. So and such things. So that's some small things, but it seems on that part to cover all these modern looking user interface design things, and that's why we brought that. We have brought also some global gesture topics on that part. We will have a new chart, Evo, where you have a multiple choice of different chart types for your facility. You can use that. And what is really a cool thing, Siemens has built up an industrial library for SVGs. So there is a big library from Siemens, which is all over all Sematic products available for your products. So you can directly use nice scaling SVGs in your facility, and they will be also updated regularly. So we start with around, I'm not sure, 100, 150 SVGs, and there will be more and more in the next years. So that's so great, and maybe on that part, I want to say thank you to the initiator on all these SVGs. She's here. Thank you, Judith, for that part, that we also can have all these SVGs from the Sematic library for your facilities. Yeah, update on Sematic Plus driver. We will bring alarming to the S7 Plus driver. We will support program alarms, system alarms, full text alarms. That's the alarming part. And the next thing is we will bring in really easy and simple importer. So as you know, when you open the browse tool from the TIA portal export, you can see in a really nice view all the data out of the TIA portal. And we will make some check marks where you say, OK, import. And then you will automatically create the data points, all the address configs, and it's all finished. And you just can go and do your work on that part, and you don't need to engineer that. Profinet, ProfiSafe, I have told you that last year that we were working on that. Yeah, we want to make a Profinet ProfiSafe certification, CL3 certification. This will be planned 2018 on a patch on 3.16. Yeah. Other driver enhancements. You have the wish OPC UA certification. Okay, we will do that on that part. Quite easy. AAP driver enhancements. We will bring in 3.16, and then we had one limitation in our really cool video feature that it was not able to have this web view, this Evo, the video Evo within mobile devices, and we will bring a possibility to have their camera pictures directly streamed to your mobile devices. Smart SCADA. We have already heard that there will be a really nice workshop tomorrow. And what will we bring on Smart SCADA? We are focusing currently on usability enhancements. We also focus on simple OEE, hierarchical KPIs. And the really important stuff is that we need more feedback from you. Who has already used Smart SCADA? Who has some inputs for us? Which KPIs you need? How is your OEE definition? Because that's not every time the same. So we have a survey for you, for all of you. Please come to us and ask us about that you can fill out and give us feedback what is missing for Smart SCADA for you that we can improve this feature for the next releases. IoT, digitalization. Bernd has already told you that. What we are doing here, we plan to make a MindSphere connector. So we will be a part, or we will have a manager who can ship data from WinCC UA to MindSphere. That's the idea on that part. So you can really easily select data, and I want to have this data transferred online to my MindSphere. that then I can analyze or do something on the analytics Mind apps, they will come for MindSphere. We will have an MQTT driver. MQTT is one of the, I think, most used IoT protocols. You have a broker and a client. So we will bring a client so we can connect WinCCOA to an official broker, MQTT broker out there in the world. And what Bernd already told, yes, we will port, or we have already ported, WinCCOA on the IoT 2040. That's the single platin box from Siemens, and that's a great thing for really nice gateway ideas and something like that. So WinCCOA make a dist connection to the local IoT server, for example. So there are a bunch of ideas and use cases. Other business logic topics, security updates. Elizabeth have already told you that we will do that. One would be server-side authentication, for example, will come with 3.16. Yeah, when we come back to the wishes we had on the beginning, start, okay, modern trend, we will bring multiple gestures, we will bring enhanced OU panels on Control++. We have already done something there. We evaluate on that part what is missing. So also give your feedback to Todd's workshop, what is missing for you for OU panels and Control++, and we will think about that when we can bring that. Smart SCADA, I've told you, please give us feedback on that. OPCUA certification, we will bring a 7+. Features not only in new versions, I think we already do that, that we will bring new features in a patch, in a feature patch, continuous delivery. But there are two wishes more or less open from this wish list. Longer release cycles and more bug fixes. When we come to the roadmap, keep in mind these two wishes. We brought the 3.15 in January. Do you know why? Because we focused 1 month from December to January just on bug fixes. We said, okay, we want to bring the major release with a much better quality to the market. So, okay, we postpone for 1 month, but on that 1 month, we're just doing bug fixes to make the quality much better than before. And I think this was the great decision. We get so good feedback on the 3.15, on the quality, on the stability, so it's really great. What will come then? 3.15 patch 3, the feature patch, I have already told you that we planned at the end of May. Then we'll bring the BACnet certification, and then, as normally, we will bring 3.16 in December. But we have these two wishes in mind, that longer release cycles and more bug fixes. So the idea we had and what we are doing is we will focus on the major releases on more bug fixes, and therefore we will ship in, or we change the release cycles to 1.5 years. So the next version, 3.16, will come in April next year to the user days, 2018. But there's one more but. We don't want to wait with all our cool features that long. So we will bring to the SPS IPC drives a feature patch for 3.15. And we will also do that for the next major release. So we will have 3.16, and we have 3.16, a feature patch with some new features, and. Yeah? And then we have 3.17, and we will also bring some feature patches for that. Yeah? So that's the idea. And then we had this OPCUA certification, which will come with 3.16, I told you. We will bring them to 3.15. We have already a lot of customers using 3.15. They want to have the certification, and they don't want to wait until 3.16 and longer. So we will plan with the OPCUA certification in Q1 2018. What is now, or what will be in this cool feature patch to the SPS drive? The two things what I have already told you that will be in the feature patch 3, yeah, is release for OU panels and JavaScript beta. But what will be now one or which of these cool features I have shown you will be part of the November, December version? So Trend 2.0 we will bring in November, December to the SPS Drive. S7 Plus Alarming and Importer we will bring. Release JavaScript in an official way so you can use it everywhere in operational mode. And there will maybe some more of them, but we will tell you that at the SPS IPC Drive, so you should plan now your travel to the Nuremberg Messe in November, December to see what will be in the feature patch of 3.15, which cool features you can then use and have in your facility. And in the end, all what is not coming in the feature patch is coming to the version 3.16, to the user days 2018. So there's also the next invitation for next user days. I don't know where, but we will see. I'm really interesting where and all that and 3.16 and all the features. And I think I'm a bit over time, but I think it was okay to show you all the nice and cool things about WinCC OA, the newest features and all that. And now I can just say thank you for listening. Have a great time today and tomorrow on the user days. Come to me, give feedback on the features and all that. And I will hand over to Bernd and say thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Lucas. Thank you, Elizabeth, for your presentations. I'm curious to hear actually what our audience thinks about all those new features, plans, and things we changed and improved, mostly based on your feedback. So I would like to invite you to discuss it now over lunch with my colleagues and myself. Lunch will be served actually on the ground floor, but please also on a gallery on the first floor. There's enough space, there is enough food for everybody. I would like to ask you to be back here at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. The stage is all for our partners, which will show, I think, a couple of very, very interesting solutions they made based on WinCC OA. There will be also the usability tests, and I think there was a change in the room. It will not be in the Renaissance Hotel. The room for the usability tests will be here in the room between the ground and the first floor. So you will find your spot which you registered for on your personal agenda or on the mobile event service. With that, I would like to wish you to enjoy the lunch and to be back here at 2 o'clock. Thank you.